Hello, everybody. Welcome to today's show. My name is Spencer Walsh. Thank you so much for joining us here today. We got a great one for you. Really liking our stories here today on this episode of Newsflash. So here is a taste of what we got. We're starting with this piece. I do want to break it down here in the New York Times. It started off a little bit dismissive, written by opinion writer Jane Costin, talking about how it was Donald Trump's CPAC because no one else came, pretty much calling Donald Trump out, saying he's irrelevant, saying no one really cares about him anymore. And we'll break down some of the claims that she makes to really decide, is that true? Is that really accurate? Is that how things stand in the Republican Party today? I'm not quite sure. Also, we'll take a look at one of the most contentious debates in, what we call the quote-unquote woke culture of the day, I guess you could say. Equality versus equity, the distinction, what does it mean, and how does it, you know, relate to the struggle and the fight for social justice. Also, slavery was wrong. No more Mary Wollstonecraft. Some of the things here in this new Washington Post report that are apparently being taken out of state textbooks due to some of these state laws, you know, in Arkansas, not just Florida, but in Arkansas and other places all across the South. We're going through some of the main instances there, really some pretty crazy stuff. Also, this week, white collar workers at Starbucks signed an open letter in solidarity with barista, and Bernie Sanders announced he will force Howard Schultz to testify before a Senate committee on union busting, and we'll get some of the attacks on Mexican President AMLO. Welcome to Newsflash today, everyone. As you can tell, it is a packed show, so let's get into it. No more time to waste. Want to get into this here. This is in the New York Times. The Conservative Political Action Conference is a festival disguised as a political meeting, a sales convention doubling as a revival. And from all intents and purposes, I personally have never been myself, but it does seem to be very true. It's a festival, it's a convention. You got people trying to sell each other's things. It's a very much a circus type environment. A lot of fanfare, definitely a kind of a high pizzazz atmosphere to be sure. It's an annual celebration of a particular kind of conservatism and this red hat wearing pin collecting enthusiasts. Really definitely some of pretty much all the strains of the traditional conservative type of person. We've got evangelicals being represented, we've got libertarians being represented. It's very much a kind of, collection of the conservative base kind of meeting up. But apparently, according to Costin, who was there, the enthusiasts didn't seem as enthusiastic as usual. Maybe it was a lackluster 2022 midterms results for Republicans, maybe. Maybe it was a reduced number of vendors for the four-day event held at the Gaylord National Resort and Convention Center in Maryland, just outside D.C. Maybe it was the gray weather. Or maybe it was the fact that there are only so many times you can threaten the return of Balal and Malak if Democrats win elections before people stop listening. So, and Laura Jadid, also of the New Republic, reporting this as well. It really just does not seem to be as, as exciting. The base doesn't seem to be kind of as crazy, at least in the eyes of the mainstream media. And I, personally, I'll believe it when I see it, because so far, I'm just hearing the mainstream media trying to read the vibes, trying to, get a handle on a group of people that they've proven time and time again, they just don't understand. They just do not have their finger on the pulse of Chud MAGA America, whatever you want to call it. They just don't know what's going on there. They can't really be, quote unquote, trusted sources when it comes to relaying what's happening, are these people, enthusiastic? How are they feeling? Who are they supporting? They're pretty strongly now, according to the CPAC straw poll that came out, they're pretty strongly in favor of Trump, at least at this time. So we'll, that's another, whole situation or discussion to have there. But Ron DeSantis decided against attending, as did former President Mike Pence and the Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell. This year's just concluded edition did not feature all, kind of the big names in American politics, conservative politics, McConnell, you know, again, here's a very important thing to remember. Mitch McConnell, Ron DeSantis, Mike Pence, you know, these people, they're all very unpopular at CPAC. They're not people who, you know, the conservative base particularly likes. You know, Mike Pence, maybe, because he's got that, you know, evangelical cred, but that's only, you know, at most, like, 30 to 40% of the Republican Party are the hardcore evangelicals who love Mike Pence. Most of them just think he's like a weirdo who, you know, they don't really care about, don't really know about. Ron DeSantis, one thing, he's kind of, you know, more for the kind of professional DC establishment nerds. He's already getting that kind of a reputation. And the real hardcore ideological conservatives, which I'm sure, you know, there's some of them, but as we saw in the straw poll, it's only about 30% of the hardcore CPAC people that are really behind Ron DeSantis. So it just kind of shows you that, you know, again, how the New York Times just does not seem to understand at this point the vibe of conservatives, because, you know, it shows you very, very clearly, you know, oh, Ron DeSantis, Mike Pence, and Mitch McConnell didn't show up. No, who cares? It doesn't matter. But the biggest name in Republican politics remains Real Donald Trump, at Real Donald, I wish he'd get back on Twitter, who spoke on Saturday night and provided perhaps the only real jolt of excitement of the weekend. At CPAC, everything is possible, and everyone is a happy warrior. The future is simultaneously terrifying and bright, with enemies who are both evil and stupid, innumerable and outnumbered by normal Americans, all of whom happen to be at CPAC, of course. But in 2023, with empty tables and wide expanses of the convention center left unoccupied, you couldn't help feel the magic of CPAC was running out. And only restoration of Trump to the White House could make CPAC great again. You know, honestly, you could have a bit of a point there. I'm not trying to deny it. Because, you know, we're beginning to see Trump get a bit of a swagger back, a bit of his excitement. You know, we don't know, you know, obviously the CPAC attendance isn't, you know, it's kind of a dipstick into how people are feeling now, not necessarily how the vibes will be once Trump begins to campaign and get his energy up, and, you know, which we're already kind of beginning to see happen. But I think that's definitely certainly something to keep in mind when you're, you know, taking an outlook at this here. Let's take a look now here at some of the a little bit of a mashup of some of the lines from CPAC of 2023 and see how they landed. All right.
If it is false, then for the good of society, and especially for the good of the poor people who have fallen prey to this confusion, transgenderism must be eradicated from public life entirely.
Yeah, that was a bit of a crazy line there from Michael Knowles, which, you know, is kind of definitely a bit of a subsection, and really is a kind of a bit of a, you know, it may be a bit of a contradiction, but, you know, I think this kind of stuff, you know, it's really is as horrific as it is, as scary as it is, and, you know, and these people all throughout so much of the country are really in power because of either weak Democratic parties or just, you know, the conservative nature of these places. The fact that they are just the vitriolic level of the hate against trans people is just becoming so, so strong, so that even the people who are, you know, kind of the happy fellow travelers, the intellectual dark web people, the Bill Maher's of the world, the people who are, you know, just, you know, we need to just take a good look about, you know, what's going on here. There's some really crazy things happening on both sides. You know, even now these people are starting to say, hey, Michael Knowles, it's getting too much. You know, Stephen Crowder, whatever, like, your hate against these trans people here is getting to be a little bit too out of control. So I think that's something that, you know, as scary as it is something that isn't going to be, you know, if Ron DeSantis, for example, runs on how much he hates trans people and all that stuff, and, you know, what he's doing in Florida to, you know, hurt or stop, you know, gender reassignment, gender reaffirming care, you know, he is not going to do very well nationally, but that doesn't mean that can't be incredibly impactful and incredibly harmful and incredibly scary on a local context for a good, good chunk of the country, not to mention just the ambient cultural hatred of trans people that this is only sure to give rise to.
If we have any reporters around, can I shoot them? And of course, I was a good officer. I always listen to my NCOs. But no, I...
You're not advocating that anybody would...
No, I would never advocate hunting the media for sport.
There's already an article...
Okay, this is one of those Kurt Schlichters, the guy who's saying that, just one of those people with no... one of the people, the run-of-the-mill conservative pundit, not really that much swag, and just kind of saying what the crowd wants to hear there.
Because I could not in good conscience remain in a party that's under the complete control of an elitist cabal of warmongers, led by the queen of warmongers herself, Hillary Clinton.
Joe and Kamala even say that America's racist. Wokeness is a virus more dangerous than any pandemic, hands down.
We had a Republican Party that was ruled by freaks, neocons, globalists, open border zealots, and fools.
Yeah, so that is the message that you can hear at the end that Trump is going there. Should be very interesting as we continue to, you know, kind of keep an eye on and watch this situation unfold. All right, let's go to our next story. And this is a bit of a controversial one. Matt Brunig writing about this. The equality versus equity distinction doesn't explain what matters for social justice. He writes, over the last decade, he says, a confused idea that started in the nonprofit sector, as all good things do, has gradually seeped into, you know, really more and more of the kind of academia and just general mainstream discourse. According to the idea, to this idea, equality is bad or inadequate, and what we really need is something called equity. There's a very kind of interesting situation. It's one of those situations where, you know, this is how personally, you know, I honestly feel about it, because, you know, especially this is interesting because it's coming from a university where, you know, this is definitely all the rage, all that kind of stuff. You know, it feels a little bit almost like weird to say, you know, if I were to say this in a class, you know, I may not, for example. But, you know, it's one of those things that where on principle, it feels both, in, you know, it feels right. It feels like it makes sense. You know, the idea of like starting people, you know, giving more to people who have been more structurally disadvantaged. But, you know, in a terms of, you know, any kind of practical way in terms of actually, you know, bringing people together, making change, and, you know, starting a broad movement, you know, this stuff, you kind of, me personally, I kind of know in my gut is just going to be in the end unsuccessful. You know, but even though it kind of feels right, it feels like, you know, that makes sense. But in practice, it may be a little bit, you know, more polarizing, more doing more harm than good. Interestingly, though, Bernie Sanders was asked to explain the difference between them on Real Time this weekend, and he was caught a little bit flat-footed. He did not quite know what to say here.
Equality. Like it's the same word, and it's not the same word in the same concept. So how would you differentiate between equity and equality?
Well, equality, we talk about, I don't know what the answer to that is. Come to think of it, you know,
Honestly, you know, respect to Bernie Sanders, because that just like you don't hear a person be like, you know what, I don't know. It's very, very rare, and I feel like that's another one of the billion reasons that, you know, that's what makes Bernie Sanders Bernie Sanders.
Is equality of opportunity. All right, we live in a society, we want all people,
right,
to have whatever color your skin is.
Equity, I think, is more guarantee of outcome, is it not?
I think so. I think that's
okay. Fine. So which side do you come down on?
Equality.
Yeah. Okay.
Right. Yeah, so I guess he just seems like he's kind of, you know, going through there, just trying to move on. But this exchange lit up both conservatives and liberals. Conservatives lit up because they associate the word equity with the diversity, equity, inclusion, DEI trainings, which, you know, make both sides of the political equation kind of light up with, you know, anger or glee. They have proliferated across the corporate sector, despite being pretty obviously pretty stupid and pretty ineffective. Liberals lit up because they have adopted this word very vigorously and think it reflects badly on Sanders that he doesn't have a spiel ready to fire off there to Bill Maher. In the meta discourse about the exchange, the debate has devolved into whether it is good or bad for politicians to use the linguistic innovations of the nonprofit or academic sectors, which at this point is a fairly well-rehearsed kind of affair. where one side says the language is very key to oppress peoples, and the other side says it's not key to them and alienates them. But missing in the discourse is an actual answer to the question presented to Sanders. How does equity differ from equality? It's Matt Bruning here. In my early 20s, I spent much of my time reading and thinking about egalitarian political philosophy of both leftist and liberal varieties. And so when people started saying that they were against equality but for equity shortly after that, I was well positioned to integrate that claim into my understandings of existing egalitarian philosophy. And it was clear that then, that as it is now, that equity is being used to mean equality in the correct unit of equality. To understand what I mean, let's look at the foundational philosophical text of the equity revolution, which is actually a, if you've been on Twitter, you know where I'm going with this one at all, is the two panel cartoon meme, which in the equity panel, in the quality panel, there's an equal distribution of boxes looking over the fence. And in the, so pretty much, yeah, for those of you who should be, you know, completely, you know, under, completely, you know, unawares of what I'm talking about here. So pretty much people are watching a baseball game, three people watching a baseball game over the fence, someone who is really short, someone who is medium short, and someone who is tall. In the equality one, the tall person is given one box, medium person given one box, and the smallest person given one box. So, you know, each person equal boxes, even though they're different heights. Equity, the shortest person gets two boxes, the medium person gets one boxes, and the one box, and the tall person gets no boxes, and they can all see over the fence. Whereas in the equality one, there only the medium and tallest person can see over the fence. Yeah, to the extent that you're supposed to get anything from that panel, it's that in the case of watching a baseball game, the correct unit of equality is sight lines, not boxes. At times, people try to boil this move down to into just being a linguistically novel way to advocate for equality of outcomes over equality of opportunity. Proponents of equity consistently reject this simplification, and from what I can tell, those proponents are actually correct to reject it. Equity is not used to promote any particular unit of equality, whether outcomes, opportunities, boxes, sight lines, luck-adjusted outcomes, primary goods, income, wealth, or capabilities, but it is instead a word that you invoke at any time you object to the unit of equality someone else is using, regardless of what, if any, your preferred alternative unit of equality is. A good case of this recently was when, back in the COVID days, the USPS announced that it would be sending 4 COVID tests to each household in the mail. In a widely popular tweet, a prominent equity advocate said that this was a perfect case to illustrate why equality is so inferior to equity. They elaborated that this program was equal because it sent same number of COVID tests to each household, but inequitable because different households had different numbers of people in them. Of course, in more natural language, where we don't keep flipping back and forth between two words, what you would say using just equality is that the USPS was equal on a per household basis, but unequal on a per person basis, and that, in the case of distributing diagnostic tests, the per person basis is the more appropriate one, because they're both equal, again, just on different bases. So the point that whether something is considered equal or not is sensitive to what unit used to measure equality is a pretty introductory concept in egalitarian thought. But advocates of equity instead use the word to mean equality of the correct unit of equality, where the correct unit of equality changes speaker to speaker and case to case, and is sometimes not actually defined at all. And given this reality, it's generally difficult to answer the question, how does equity differ from equality, when asked in the general way Bill Maher did. And as a final note, I will say that there is one thing that slightly annoys me about the meta discourse on this exchange that focuses on the value of academic language. This is a worthwhile discourse generally, but it has actually been slightly backward in this case. The academic discourse in egalitarianism is both interesting and clear in tackling the equality of what question. What we have with equity is non-academics who clearly have no familiarity with the relevant academic discourse coming up with a half-baked and badly theorized version of it. My name is Spencer Walsh. This is the Spencer Walsh Radio Network. And if you're listening to one of our podcasts, whether it's Newsflash, Hidden History, The Spencer Walsh Show, or something else, ladies and gentlemen, we have one simple request of you. Please be sure to rate us, subscribe to us if you like us, and leave us a comment, because just like all of you, sometimes we need that feedback in our lives, good or bad. We want to hear what you have to say. So please do those steps. Make SWRN content better. And thank you so much for listening. All right, ladies and gentlemen. This is kind of a really remarkable situation that we are seeing here all over the South. Excerpts from Mary Wollstonecraft's A Vindication of the Rights of Women. Passages from Christopher Columbus's journal describing his brutal treatment of indigenous peoples, and a data set on the New York Police Department's use of force analyzed by race. These are among the items teachers have nixed from their lesson plans this school year and last, as they face pressure from parents worried about political indoctrination and administrators wary of controversy, as well as a spate of new state laws restricting education on race, gender, and LGBTQ issues. It's a really kind of horrific situation, because I think this is kind of a thing that a lot of people were just like, you know, this is not going to be, you know, this is, I feel like a lot of conservatives were like, all the way back to, you know, the debates over the Confederate flag days, you know, liberals are trying to censor our history, they're trying to, you know, take away free speech and all of this stuff. And, you know, and this is really what the critical race theory stuff was, you know, and that, you know, that is definitely what, you know, that's definitely really what the root of it was. It was just trying to, again, teach the history that you like, and teach the history that, you know, conforms to your ideology of America is good, America is, you know, unquestionable, and, you know, anything that, you know, it's just so base and so stupid, because it's just like, oh, you're talking about women's rights. There's a, you know, gay stuff in this. We're striking it down. It's not like any kind of broader thought. It's no intellectual curiosity, no intellectual rigor behind it whatsoever. It's absolutely insane that these people, who are really only interested in carrying out kind of a right wing ideological Christian religious jihad here, are just taking over the educational system in this country. The quiet censorship comes as debates over whether and how to instruct children about race, racism, U.S. history, and gender identity and sexuality inflame politics and consume the nation. These fights, which have generated at least 64 state laws reshaping what children can learn and do at school, are likely to intensify ahead of the 2024 presidential election. So let's go to example number one. So this is the Fairfield Community School District Superintendent talking about slavery in Iowa. Let's take a listen.
Knowing that I should stick to the facts.
Greg Wickenkamp. He began reevaluating how he teaches 8th grade social studies in June 2021 when a new Iowa law barred educators from teaching the United States of America and the state of Iowa are fundamentally or systemically racist and sexist. Wickenkamp did not understand what this legislation, which he felt was vaguely worded, meant for his pedagogy. Could he still use the youth edition of the Indigenous Peoples' History of the United States, which I believe is Howard's Zinn? Should he stay away from Jason Reynolds and Ibram Kendi's stamped racism, anti-racism, and you, especially as Kendi came under attack from conservative politicians? This fall, Wickenkamp repeatedly sought clarification from the Fairfield Community School District about what he could say in class, according to emails obtained by the Post. He sent detailed lists of what he was teaching and what he planned to teach and asked for formal approval, drawing little response. At the same time, Wickenkamp was fielding unhappy emails and social media posts from parents who disliked his enforcement of the district's masking policy and his use of Reynolds and Kendi's texts. A local politician alleged Wickenkamp was teaching critical race theory to children. And then, you know, obviously things went crazy. And this is a Zoom meeting that he finally got this teacher here with the superintendent to talk a bit more about it.
Knowing that I should stick to the facts and knowing that to say slavery was wrong, that's not a fact. That's a stance. Is it acceptable for me to teach students that slavery was wrong?
I think it goes back to the part with critical race theory is that we can say this is what happened, and again, you probably know more about it than I do, Greg, and I think that's maybe even Maya and Laura's both, is that this is all new stuff, but in my opinion is here is what happened in our history, and we had people that that were slaves within our state. we're not supposed to say to them, how does that make you feel? We can't. Or does that make you feel bad? We're not to do that part of it. To say, is slavery wrong? I really need to delve into it to see, is that part of what we can or cannot say? And I don't know that, Greg, because that's...
Yeah, I mean, if slavery is wrong, you know, it's a tough decision. I got to check in with the supervisors. You know, that is what education has come to in so many parts of this country. If it's not going to be, you know, completely privatized, it's not, you know, completely, you know, screwed up and, you know, right-wing religiously controlled, then it is, you know, incredibly inaccessible, incredibly prohibitive cost-wise, and very, you know, only available really to the rich or people who live in rich communities somehow. I mean, it is, yeah, it's a very, very dark situation because... You know, I don't know if this person really believes what she's kind of pushing here, but it doesn't really matter at the end of the day. For 14 years, a North Carolina social studies teacher taught excerpts of Christopher Columbus's journal without incident. The point was to show how Columbus's marriage of enslavement with his quest for profit helped shape the world we live in today. The teacher, who spoke on the condition of anonymity for fear of harassment, directed children to the first chapter of Howard Zinn's People's History of the United States. Titled Columbus, the Indians, and Human Progress, throughout the chapter, students encountered paragraphs taken from the Explorer's Journal in which Columbus delineated his views and interactions with the Native peoples of America. You know, this is literally an incredibly – this is a literally – from a show that was released in, what, the 1990s, early 2000s, this is literally read aloud in one of the best – most – widely recognized as the best show in American television history. This exact quote, which is kind of what was causing all the irony or, you know, all the ire, I guess you could say. As soon as I arrived – in the Indies, on the first island which I found, I took some of the natives by force, Columbus wrote in October 1492, in a slice of the journal quoted by Zinn. They would make fine servants. With 50 men, we could subjugate them all. With 50 men, we could subjugate them all, and make them do whatever we want. You know, and that is an incredibly well-known part of just, you know, who Christopher Columbus is, whether you watched The Sopranos or whether you didn't. And I think that is, like, the fact that this is now completely being cast out of our culture, and there's going to be people in the year 2023 who are going to school, going to fifth grade, sixth grade, whatever, you know, and just not being, just completely... not being able to understand, you know, what happened in basic, really basic American history, not pre-American history, about how bad Columbus was and whether or not he was a good person. Like, this is something I knew in, like, sixth grade. It's very, very clear. Like, this is, you know, I had to go to the clip to The Sopranos.
That's just one person's opinion, Anthony.
What, football again? He's not going to get hurt. He's a tough kid.
Oh, Jesus.
We're having a discussion about Christopher Columbus.
They would make fine servants. With 50 men, we could subjugate them.
Subjugate?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, there you go. This probably was released in 2001. Like, this is a very well-understood part of American culture, and it's being completely cast out of education. A self-described nerd, a North Virginia teacher who has always used math to explain the world around her, the woman who spoke on the condition of anonymity for fear of professional consequences became a statistics teacher in Loudoun County Public School because she wanted to imbue children with the same love of math. Last academic year, the teacher's statistics class was diverse along racial lines, she said, partly in hopes of appealing to her students of color, but mostly because she wanted young people to know that math can be used to reveal how society works. She taught a lesson built around a data set exploring the outcomes of the NYPD's Stop and Frisk program. Analyzing the findings shows that citizens of color saw higher rates of police use of force, she told students. The whole purpose of that lesson was to drive home the point, okay, there was an association, but that we can't necessarily conclude that race is the cause of the difference. The idea, association is not causation. So essentially, relatively conservative argument saying, you know, don't jump to conclusions here. And this was an incredibly, controversial idea. At a mandatory professional development session the following summer, administrators warned that Virginia teachers, especially those in Loudoun County, are under a microscope right now, the teacher said. Staffers understood the comment, she said, as a reference to Glenn Youngkin's first day executive order limiting education on race and divisive concepts, the tip line he set up allowing parents to report teachers, and his intense scrutiny of the Loudoun district for its handling of two student sexual assaults. The teacher asked higher-ups if she could stop teaching her lesson on the police use of force. She was told yes, because it might make children uncomfortable because of their race, or if their parents are police officers, the teacher recalled. Asked about the huge account, Loudoun School's spokesman, Dan Adams, wrote an email about blah, 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 you know, whatever. In Arkansas last year, the 12th grade English teacher, Lisa Childers, was struggling to interest her students in Tara Westover's Educated, a memoir about growing up a survivalist Mormon family from a splinter sect. There's no little point in educating women, but she saw a glimmer of curiosity from a handful of female students intrigued by Westover's references to Mary Wollstonecraft, an 18th century British philosopher and writer best known for her passionate argument for women's equality, a vindication of the rights of women, you know, something I learned about tons of times throughout school. Childers decided to suggest passages of optional reading from the text, men considering females rather as women than human creatures. Wollstone wrote in one, have been more anxious to make them alluring mistresses and affectionate wives and rational mothers, and the understanding of the sex has been hobbled. Childers said she wanted female students to know that women had struggled to learn for centuries. But on January 18, 2022, the assistant principal of Bryan High School apparently alerted to the Wollstonecraft assignment after reviewing Childers' syllabus online, sent an email with the heading, questions about a document, please respond, and she eventually got in a bit of trouble. The assistant principal never offered a reason for her objections, but earlier that year, the same person had objected to a teacher's proposed assignment on an essay on toxic masculinity by writing in an email reviewed by the Post that educators should bring in articles of empathy and compassion rather than something that could be negatively triggering to our students, which is a kind of an interesting way of phrasing it, to say the least. All right. So, yeah, those are just some examples. The full list there is on the Washington Post. Let's go to our next story.
In the latest trap, got stopped by a late cop. She got me thinking I could date a cop. Cause her uniform fit so tight. She ran me by the right. She put me in a pile. She caught up all the lights. She said I have the right to remain silent. Now I gotta holler. Sounded like a siren.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are getting now into our last story. So after more than a year of fighting, or sorry, second to last story, after more than a year of fighting intense and often illegal union busting by Starbucks, the clouds definitively broke for unionizing baristas. Three separate allies came forward midweek in support of the militant workers. First, dozens of the company's own white-collar workers went into open revolt, releasing a letter to the public making clear their support for the baristas and opposing new back-to-the-office rules. Then Bernie Sanders' office announced the committee he chairs in the U.S. Senate will seek to subpoena Howard Schultz to testify under oath about the company's labor practices. Then, probably the most important one here, the NLRB issued a ruling against the company, stating in a 200-plus page document, Starbucks had engaged in egregious and widespread misconduct, demonstrating a general disregard for employees' fundamental rights in Buffalo, in New York. And really, that was just on Wednesday. Things are starting to boil to the top, said Boston-based barista Sky Bauer Rowe. It just needs a little bit more temperature. At about 9 a.m., Bloomberg broke a story about an open letter from several white-collar employees of the union lending support to the barista co-workers. The workers, many of whom hold tech roles, criticized the company for tampering with the federal rights of store partners to have fair elections free from fear, coercion, and intimidation. The letter, which also drew attention to the signatory's own workplace issues, slammed Starbucks for a poorly planned return-to-office mandate that prioritized corporate control. So that is definitely something to keep an eye on. But I do want to focus a little bit more here on this NLRB ruling or decision here. And we could, you know, take a little, you know, Although the Sanders thing, I think, certainly will be nice. It'll be good to see him getting in there and having Schultz answer some questions. So now we're going to go to the NLRB. And workers there, throughout Starbucks all across the country, have long alleged that Starbucks is engaged in massive union busting in Buffalo, including store closures, firings, and other direct interference with the right of organizers under the cover of night. Direct interference with the right to organize, under the cover of night. With the support of parent organization Workers United, SPWU workers registered hundreds of allegations of illegal union busting by Starbucks with the NLRB. It's very validating to have this 200-page document basically saying, you're right, he did all these things, said Casey Moore, an SPWU spokesperson. If it is held up on potentially multiple appeals, the decision would reinstate or compensate dozens of workers for illegal union busting they endured, including seven who were fired. The judge ordered dozens of other remedies as well. For example, the judge also ruled the store was illegally shut down and it will have to be reopened. Starbucks will also be forced to acknowledge to all of its baristas worldwide through electronic channels a detailed and lengthy list of what has been ordered to commit to by the NLRB, just so that everyone knows, so it's all out there. And I think this is really one of the biggest benefits to having Biden in the White House and having someone in Jennifer Abruzzo who is actually running the NLRB in a very competent way. Like, this is something that would not have happened under Trump, and the Starbucks Workers Union would not be nearly as strong, nearly as well supported. Amazon as well. It would not be nearly as successful without these victories and this research and this kind of legal support by the NLRB into all the kind of bad and, you know, again, illegal things that they are doing. So very, very big deal there. All right, now we get to our last story. On February 23rd, an electoral reform bill received its final approval in the Mexican Senate en route to being signed into law. The day before, New York Times bureau chief Natalie Kitroff, demonstrating an ongoing inability to distinguish between a news article and an opinion piece, declared that the law was the most significant in a series of moves by the Mexican president to undermine the country's fragile institutions. Oh no! When the New York Times starts saying your institutions are fragile, that's when things get real. That's when things really begin to get a little interesting for you and your democracy, especially if you're on the left, which obviously AMLO is there. And, this country has had, you know, very functional elections, you know, there's definitely corruption has been a problem. A lot of that has ties to certain United States interests, but, corruption has definitely been a problem in the country, but it's a country that's had very successful elections, for quite a long time. And now that, you know, haven't really been interrupted, there's not been any storming capitals any time in the past, for example, and now all of a sudden their institutions are very, very fragile. I mean, if that's the case, you know, they've been plenty more fragile and, you know, more successful in kind of holding together than the United States institutions have been in a bit. You know, they've been under duress for quite some time. You know, check out Narcos Mexico, getting a sense of how long institutions in Mexico have been quote-unquote fragile, but they seem to do all right. But, you know, so they really get fragile, at least in New York Times' eyes, when a leftist leader comes along. So it is, the reform stance. So this is like, for example, if the that voting bill, I forget the name of it, the Democrats wanted to pass and pretended to try and pass and eventually got, you know, stopped by Joe Manchin. About, you know, the electoral reforms, the, you know, ranked choice, whatever they were trying to do. This is essentially kind of a very similar situation. You could AMLO trying to pass this bill, but instead he's got the international press, led by the richest country in the history of the world, coming out and saying, oh, this is a threat to democracy. Institutions are being, you know, put under attack here. You know, our index is going to rank you lower. Our democracy index is going to rank you lower for this. You know, this is a bad thing here, AMLO. For his part, David Frum, who, together with his editor at The Atlantic, Jeffrey Goldberg, were the key purveyors of the lies that justified the Bush administration's invasion of Iraq, took to the pages of the magazine to warn that the liberal democracy in Mexico is under assault by Mexico's erratic and authoritarian president. In Mexico last week, I found virtual unanimity among academics, business people, and political commentators. The country's democracy is now in real danger. Did you? Financial Times' Gideon Rachman, undoubtedly tapping into an extremely unrepresentative sample of the nation. And not to be left out, and by the way, AMLO, one of the most popular leaders in the world right now. So Definitely some context that probably was not included in these mainstream media reports. Not to be left out, the NPR reports warned that the new law gutted the country's electoral commission. Yes, gutted, constituting a blow to its young democracy. In contrast to the lurid sensationalism of the Anglo-American establishment press, the actual law is quite mundane. The National Electoral Institute is widely recognized to be riddled with excess expenditure and a top-heavy bureaucracy. The new law simply mandates similar cost-saving measures to those the administration of President Andres Manuel López Obrador has applied to other government departments. It eliminates duplicate functions at the local and district level and fuses certain high-level job descriptions. It also reins in eye-catching top salaries, and by means of comparison, in a country where the minimum wage is approximately $10 per day, the head of the institute makes the pre-tax equivalent of some $13,000 per month in U.S. dollars, plus benefits, bonuses, a vehicle, a private insurance plan, generous phone and food stipends, a battery of 11 advisors, four of whom earn more than the president. So, again, yeah, this electoral commission where all these guys are getting paid, apparently, according to the international press, you know, some more than the president, was just a beacon of democracy. No corruption, nothing sketchy or shady going on there. The legislation does have its debatable points. Questions exist as to how the Foreign Relations Secretary, an arm of the government, is going to administer international voting in the absence of the INE. Conservatives are particularly up in arms about provisions to allow foreign voters to vote with their passports instead of their voter ID cards that are obligatory within Mexico. There are concerns that an excess of flexibility may allow parties to play fast and loose in applying gender and minority candidacy quotas, and others worry that a clause prohibiting slander in political advertising could have an inhibiting effect on free speech. All those are valid observations, but far from the apocalyptic hysteria of the English press. Of course, nothing could be further from the interest of From Kitroff & Co. than to engage in a good faith discussion of the ins and outs of Mexico's electoral intricacies. The objective here is to utilize their positions in major media outlets both to bludgeon and caricature AMLO and the campaign promises of his fourth transformation, or 4T. In doing so, they're fulfilling the historical role of Western corporate media throughout Latin America, which is to provide an international mouthpiece to an upper-class caste of elites in order to head off the possibility of even moderate reform to profoundly unjust and unequal societal structures. In the process, and with gross irresponsibility, this media scrum is clearly attempting to goad the Biden administration, already up to its neck in Ukraine while rattling sabers with China, into a reckless response with Mexico that could escalate just as easy. The copy has already been written, and the target duly demonized. Democracy under attack by erratic autocrat, failed narco-state, requires intervention. This is, you know, some very, very similar refrains here that we've seen, or familiar refrains that we've seen in the past from the United States and, you know, its foreign policy of the past. So there's definitely going to be something here to keep an eye on. This language of democracy under attack, concerns have been raised. Well, you know, the concerns really, in the end, I think, should lie with the Mexican people in the debates. You know, the legitimate discussions that we said, we talked about, mentioned in that article, that could and will be had. And you know, with that being said, that's all the debating we have time for on the show for today. We'll be back maybe on Wednesday, but if not on Friday. It's been Newsflash.